Well, hello, everyone. My name is Laura Ryder, and I'm the Conservation Education Program Supervisor for the Fish and Game Department and your host today. So welcome to our second webinar in a series of four webinars on climate change and wildlife in New Hampshire. This series is designed to provide what we know about climate change in New Hampshire and specifically how New Hampshire's wildlife is being affected. The topics we're focusing on are taken from New Hampshire's Wildlife Action Plan, which is a guiding document for taking action to benefit species in greatest conservation in need. The plan was developed by Fish and Game and many conservation partners in New Hampshire. The first webinar was an introduction to climate change and wildlife, was recorded on April 15th. It can be found on our climate change website pages and the Fish and Game YouTube channel. Today's webinar will also be recorded and put in those exact same locations. So please share these out to your networks and let people know they can access these at any time. Just sort of a really brief rundown you can see on the slide in front of you today. As part of this webinar series presentation today, we will have a climate change video. We're going to have a brief description of exactly what phenology is, and we're going to have a presentation on moose and climate change in New Hampshire, and we'll have a Q&A afterwards. So the people that are currently on our panel, I don't know if you can see them or not, but I'd like to introduce them. Nicola Whitley, the chief of our public affairs division, part of our climate team. Judy Tomosa, Fish and Game's Watershed Education Specialist. Lindsay Webb, our Wildlife Education Specialist. And our main presenter today is Henry Jones. He's a wildlife biologist for the Fish and Game Department. And Henry also focuses on managing the moose population in New Hampshire and is presenting on how climate change is impacting New Hampshire's moose population today. There will be opportunities to ask questions after Henry's presentation. So if you have any comments as we go, could you please post them in the chat box, which you can find, it says chat down at the bottom of your screen if you put your cursor over that. And if you have questions, we will get to them later, but any questions we would ask that you please post them in the Q&A box, which you can also find down at the bottom of your screen entitled Q&A. So to start things off, we have a video produced just for this series. So sit back and enjoy the video as we get started. Thank you.
Part of what makes New Hampshire awesome is the wildlife and habitats that are found in the state. New Hampshire is lucky to have many diverse habitats and species of wildlife that everyone has access to. Whether you hunt, fish, or watch wildlife, there are many opportunities to enjoy the world outside. The changes happening to our climate are affecting plants and wildlife in New Hampshire. As you observe and enjoy the habitats around you, maybe you have noticed some of these changes. Storms are more intense, with drought conditions in between. This impacts the way aquatic organisms live and move in these habitats. Summer temperatures are hot, with more days reaching 90 degrees Fahrenheit than ever before. This sustained heat not only impacts us, but wildlife that need to take refuge in cooler areas. Without early and regular snowpack, winter wildlife struggles as well. Like moose carrying heavy loads of winter tick, or snowshoe hare that have turned white before the first snowfall. Traditionally, insect hatch and flower blooms match up. But because of changes to our climate, this relationship is shifting as well, meaning animal food sources are not available as needed. Rising seawater levels and extreme storms along our seacoast impact coastal areas. In addition to being a challenge for wildlife, these events also affect the quality of fishing, hunting, and wildlife watching experiences. Later ice in and earlier ice out are changing when and how long we can ice fish. The New Hampshire Fish and Game Department, along with many partners, are already studying wildlife and habitat relationships and working on actions to help reduce climate change impacts on the plants and animals that call the Granite State home. The effort to help wildlife will involve all of us. Planting native trees and flowers, participating in citizen science, making environmentally friendly choices like porous pavement or collecting rainwater for your garden, and being aware of your impact is a start. It is important that we observe and understand how these changes are playing out, especially how they will influence our human species. Climate change over time will affect all the ways we enjoy the natural resources of New Hampshire, such as wildlife watching, hunting, fishing, fall foliage viewing, and other types of nature tourism. We need to adapt as well.
Well, great. That was great. Thanks to the climate change team for producing that video. Now, next, Lindsay Webb will take the wheel and provide us with some background on what exactly phenology means when we talk about climate change.
Great. So, what is phenology? Phenology is the study of the timing of recurring biological events. Perhaps without even realizing it, you use phenology in your own life. You may know what week is the best to start planting your garden, or know what months your allergies start acting up, or when black fly season will begin. Some other examples of phenology include the timing of bird migration, flowering plants, and the timing of nesting. Phenology is important because it affects whether plants and animals thrive or survive in their environments. We know that plants and animals may adjust the timing of certain phenological events based on changes in weather. However, it's important that we also understand how the timing of phenological events is changing over longer time frames as climate conditions change. A mismatch in timing can occur when plants and animals that rely on these certain predictive patterns. While some species can adjust to the increase in unseasonable temperatures, drought, or extreme storms that have come with climate change, not all species will be able to respond at the same speed or in the same ways. This can disrupt the manner in which species interact and the way that ecosystems function overall. Understanding how changing climate conditions are impacting plant and animal phenology is essential for making effective adaptive management decisions. And there's lots of ways for you to get involved in studying phenology in your area. Here are a few of the many citizen science phenology projects that are happening across the state, country, and across the world. And so if you're interested in this topic, I encourage you to get involved in contributing to this valuable science data. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Lindsay. You know, and even right now, given the season that we're in, right? I mean, this is kind of an important time for sort of the ending of winter and the beginning of spring and the arrival of birds. This is a good time to observe some of that timing, phenology timing, I'll just say that. Okay, and now we're going to turn it over to Henry Jones on climate change and how phenology is impacting New Hampshire's moose population. Henry.
Great, thank you, Laura. And I'm going to share my screen here to get going on with the presentation. Great, so thanks again. And yes, my name is Henry Jones. I'm the Moose Project Leader for Fish and Game, and here to talk with you about moose and climate change today. And so, you know, when moose and climate change first come to mind, you know, moose are a species of the north. And so we may think, you know, hot temperatures like we're experiencing now becoming more frequent is impacting our moose. And someday, yes, you know, if things continue, that will occur. But moose are pretty adaptable to short-term fluctuations of extreme temperatures. They can, you know, go lie in a cool stream or in a bog in some shade, or use a pond as in this photo. What's really been affecting our moose in New Hampshire is how climate is affecting two parasites that negatively influence moose. It's been positively influencing them, and parasites have an ability to adapt really quickly to climate. So yeah, let's dig into some details here and go from there. So first, let's start with a little background. Moose distribution. On the left is a map of moose distribution in North America. As you can see, New Hampshire is at the extreme southern edge of moose distribution, so we are vulnerable to shifts of moose range north due to warming climate. At right is a map of moose density or abundance per area in New Hampshire. The dark blue is more moose per area, and the gray and the tan is less moose per area. So you can see moose density, moose abundance declines from north to south. The majority of the moose population in New Hampshire is north of the White Mountains, north of the Notches. And that's not to say, you know, in central and southern New Hampshire, there certainly are pockets of moose that even extend down into Massachusetts and Connecticut. So there are pockets that exist further south. Here is statewide moose abundance in New Hampshire. And this is how we use as an index of moose abundance. Is the number of moose seen by deer hunters in the fall. And so as you can see, we're currently about half of our peak in the late 90s. And it's important to remember that prior to 1980, there were very few moose in the state. And so our history of moose is relatively short, 20, 40 years. It's important to keep that in mind as we progress through this presentation. And so, you know, what happened, you know, to cause that very rapid and substantial increase of moose from 1970 to 2000. Well, you know, so moose are browsers. They eat leaves, twigs, leafy vegetation. And so at that time, from 1970 to 2000, the forests in the northern New England and the Northeast had matured from deforestation during colonization. And so they'd reached a size and age where they were starting to be harvested. Additionally, there was an outbreak of an insect called the spruce budworm in northern New Hampshire. Both of these factors combined resulted in more frequent harvesting of our forest that created a lot of young forest 4 to 16 years old, that creates really great browse for moose, and consequently the population responded very strongly. However, no population, or very few, can grow indefinitely. And so something was going to catch up with this population. So you can see, you know, that graph shows in the upper right that the population declined, and the habitat hadn't changed. We still have quite a bit or adequate regenerating forest, young forest for moose food. So what happened? And so to get at this, New Hampshire Fish and Game and UNH combined efforts and substantial resources and radiomarked over 300 moose in two different studies, one in 2002, one in 2014 to 2018, to really understand what is going on with our moose population in New Hampshire. And just to note that picture on the lower left, so the best way to catch moose and to put a radio collar on them is to net them from a helicopter. So that picture is taken out of an open door of a helicopter with a net shot across the front of this moose while it was running. That holds the moose up, and then capture crew climbs out of the helicopter, hobbles the moose, puts a blindfold on it and the collar on. So just real quick, that's the side note. But yes, this research also, it occurred in northern New Hampshire, the greater Milan area, and conducted there because this is really the core of moose range in New Hampshire, and it's where the population is expected to persist the longest. And so what were those research findings? Well, it's really that winter tick parasitism is causing the decline in our moose population in New Hampshire, at least northern New Hampshire, which has the largest influence on the statewide population because that's where most of the moose are. So to note here, the winter tick is a different species of tick than you and I are typically getting on us right now. I don't know about you, but I've been getting quite a few American dog ticks on me right now, and they look a lot like the two ticks in the center of that photo. However, this is the winter tick is a different species of tick. Those two winter ticks in the center of the photo, those are your adult unengorged winter ticks. They're in that life stage and form in March and April. It's also important to note that the winter tick is a natural tick in New Hampshire. It naturally occurs here. And so to understand how winter ticks are influencing moose, we need to understand the winter tick life cycle. So this time of year through to August, winter ticks are eggs in the duff layer. Then in late August, September, those eggs hatch into larvae, and the larvae ascend the vegetation and they quest for a host. They're trying to get on a host, and it's most commonly moose. And so they stay questing until sustained temperatures below freezing or lasting snow, 3 to 4 days of snow or more. And so if they can't find a host and those conditions arrive, then they die. Life cycle ends, they don't lay eggs. If they do attach to a host, they stay on the host, in this case moose, all winter. So October, November, all the way to March and April. And over that time, they take a couple of blood meals, but it's really the March and April blood meal. That's when these winter ticks are in their adult life stage, and those adult females take 2 to 3 milliliters of blood each. And it's, so it's that blood meal there in March and April that's of most consequence that we'll talk about here the most. Also important to note is when those winter ticks fall off, do they fall into snow? Those engorged adult females, do they fall into snow? Or they fall onto bare ground. That influences their fitness and the number of eggs they lay. And then the cycle repeats if it's all successful. And so how do ticks kill moose? Well, really, it's a numbers game. We're talking about 30 to 90,000 plus winter ticks on moose that end up dying from those infestations. And commonly this in radiomark calves that died due to high winter tick infestations, the average was 45,000. So here's the scenario. Moose in winter, the natural browse that's available to them is fairly low on the nutritional scale. And so they naturally lose weight, just like white-tailed deer. This occurs even on the best moose range. So then you add on 30,000 plus winter ticks. And so when those adult winter ticks start taking a blood meal, that itches. And those moose are then spending time trying to itch and get those winter ticks off them. As you can see in that center photo, that cow has rubbed all of her hair off her tops of her shoulders and her rump there due to irritation associated with the ticks. So that's more time rubbing, less time feeding. Additionally, and most importantly, is the blood loss associated with these winter ticks. It comes over a concentrated 8-week period in March and April, and it's really substantial. And what it results in is an added energetic demand that that animal has to meet. And so they don't have this in their forage. They need it with their fat and muscle resources. So these moose have to catabolize their fat and muscle to meet this added energy demand to replace all of this lost blood. So there you have it, you know, lost blood, protein deficiency, anemia. And what results? Well, so for calf moose that are less than a year old, they don't have enough resources in many cases to meet this added energy demand. They use all their fat and muscle trying to meet that energy demand and make more blood, but they run out of resources and die. For adults, they typically survive, but that added energy demand puts them in poorer condition. They have to use up more of their fat and muscle in order to make it through the spring. And so what did that research show us that's occurring in northern New Hampshire? So for late winter calf mortality, these are your collared moose that are less than a year old. In 2002 to 2005, one of 4 years had really high winter tick impact. And your average calf mortality was 33%. So 33% of 10 to 12 month old calves were dying in March and April. In 2014 to 2018, that had increased to 4 out of 5 years had high winter tick impact. And on average, 70% of these calves were dying. Additionally, with adults, we said, you know, they're in poor physical condition due to the added energetic demand. And so with adult cows, what you have is this is occurring at the same time as they're growing and producing a calf. And so what's facing an adult cow at this time is, you know, the cost of growing that calf, the last trimester of gestation and the first 1 to 2 weeks of lactation. Then you have the demands for that cow just to stay alive. And then you have the demands of winter ticks. And so what that added energetic demand of winter ticks does is takes away resources that that cow would put towards producing that calf. So in 2002 to 2005, most cows, 85% had calves on a given year, and 75% would have calves in successive years. So most could recover and have a calf again in a following year. And that's indicative of a moose population that's in normal to good physical condition. In 2014 to 2018, that had decreased. Only 62% of cows had calves on a given year, and only 25% would have calves on a back-to-back year. So fewer cows were having calves on a given year because it was taking them longer to recover. And if they did have a calf, it's only going to be a singleton. Twinning is very uncommon, which is what you see from animals in good condition. Bottom line is winter tick infestation and impact had worsened over time. And so what influences winter tick abundance then? Well, first it's moose density, or I shouldn't say first, but one of the major factors is moose density. And so low moose abundance equals fewer winter ticks, right? So let's flip that around. We know that with winter ticks, they need to get onto a host in the fall in order to survive and lay eggs. So with more host around, more moose around, that results in a greater likelihood of them getting on a host, surviving and laying eggs. And so as such, the fewer you have, the fewer host, the lower the likelihood goes down, then you can result in fewer winter ticks on a landscape level. The second thing influencing winter tick abundance is climate. So short winters are ideal for the winter tick life cycle. And so this gets back to that life cycle as well. So fall questing, the amount of time that winter ticks have to get on moose is really important. And so if you have a long fall, if it takes a long time for cold and snow to show up, then those ticks have a long time to get on moose, will result in more winter ticks on moose at a lower abundance of moose. The next factor is that spring drop-off season. In March and April, are those winter ticks dropping onto bare ground or are they dropping onto snow? If they fall onto snow, those adult engorged females are in better condition and lay more eggs. And so I just wanted to note there's a little blue circle there. There are some engorged adult female winter ticks in the duff layer there in the snow. And so, you know, what's occurring in New Hampshire and in the Northeast? We have a map here, a chart created by Dr. Alexei Seren. And this shows where we see the highest winter tick impact on moose in the Northeast, northern New Hampshire, northern Vermont, and western Maine. This is where moderate abundance of moose meets weather that's really ideal for winter ticks. And so what do we expect for the future of moose in northern New Hampshire and much of, you know, northern New England? Well, we expect the population to continue to continue. What we know is that moose are still in poor condition from high winter tick infestations, and that population is going to continue slowly over time, and it declines slowly because your adults typically survive. What really influences the trajectory of your population is adult survival, adult cow survival. So our adult cows continue to survive, so it's a more gradual decline. And at some point, we'll reach an abundance level that limits winter tick abundance, an abundance level of moose that limits winter ticks and their life cycle. And that will result in fewer winter ticks on the landscape. And our moose will be bounce back and be in good condition, and that population will increase. We know this to be true because we have good habitat. And through all that research, we've seen a couple oddball years where winter tick abundance has been slightly lower, moose quickly respond. So that moose population will respond, but winter ticks lag the moose population, and so they'll quickly catch up, and we'll see kind of that poor condition and the cycle somewhat repeat itself. So this is for northern New Hampshire and the bulk of our moose population. It's important to note that that moose abundance that results in fewer winter ticks is lower due to climate change. So that, and that gets back to those winter ticks have more time to get on moose in the fall, more time to find that host and survive. The other major parasite that's going to have a greater influence on the moose population, let's say south of the Whites and throughout most of the river valleys in the States, is brain worm or P. tenuis. And so this infection with this worm results in neurological disease of moose, weakness, blindness, circling, head tilt, as you can see in the picture on the lower right. And it's a very small worm that sits in the central nervous system, the spinal cord, or up in the brain, the meninges. And mortality is dose dependent. So this is important for our next explanation. So moose can survive really low infections of this worm. However, if they get infected with a higher dose, that's when those neurological diseases symptoms are more severe, resulting in death. So brain worm, what influences moose exposure and therefore their ability to survive? So let's go through the brain worm life cycle, and that'll get us to the bottom of that. So deer are the primary host for brain worm. Actually, most white-tailed deer have brain worm sitting in their meninges, and it does not cause them any clinical disease. They pass larvae in their feces, and then snails and slugs crawl on those feces and become infected with an infective stage of the larva, of the brain worm larva. And then those snails and slugs climb the vegetation, and old Mr. Moose comes along and accidentally ingests a snail or slug, resulting in an infection. So if there are more deer around, then you're going to have more infected snails and slugs that will then result in an increased risk of moose having a higher infection rate with brain worm. So in areas where you see long-term sustained increase of deer abundance above moderate to high, you know, into moderate to high deer abundance levels, then you could see long-term decline in your moose due to this increased exposure to brain worm. And so I will just note that climate change predictions are that we, you know, shorter winters will continue in New Hampshire, and winter length is one of the factors. Winter length and severity are some of the factors influencing deer abundance. So we may see increased deer abundance in New Hampshire due to climate change. So what is the future for moose in New Hampshire? Well, first of all, fewer moose, but not likely to disappear. Remember, you know, we're comparing moose abundance to, you know, most people remember back 15, 20 years ago, and we're comparing to peak moose abundance. You know, we got to remember this story is relatively short, 20 to 40 years old. We're still finding what's normal for our moose populations. Additionally, so we need to adapt in some ways our thinking on what is normal for New Hampshire. And what's important here too is that, you know, in northern New Hampshire, where winter ticks are our primary limiting factor for moose, winter ticks aren't going to cause moose to disappear. They'll result in fewer moose, but not disappearance. In central and southern New Hampshire, that may be different with increases, with potential increase of ringworm exposure. So, you know, how many moose and for how long depends on our actions now. There are many factors influencing moose, and so, you know, there's things that we can do now, though, that will help, you know, impact, you know, that help influence those factors that may ultimately result in moose abundance removal from New Hampshire if we don't act. And so the first is habitat. You know, moose require large blocks of forested habitat with the ability to manage and to create young forests. So we need to conserve these habitats. As you can see in the orange and the green there, that's your habitat that's most ideal for moose. That's northern hardwoods, transitional boreal forest species that are most nutritious for moose. So we need to conserve large blocks of forest so we don't lose that habitat. Additionally, we need to minimize human contribution to climate change. You know, so extremes in temperatures could result in, you know, if the extreme climate change predictions occur, then we could have temperatures that do limit moose. And so trying to contribute, you know, minimize our contribution to that and avoid those more severe scenarios is definitely what needs to happen if we want to have moose in New Hampshire long term. And so finally, I'll just end with, you know, a slide of a cow with calf of twins. And so this is what you really want to see. And so twins are indicative of a cow in really good condition. And right now is peak timing for moose to have calves, May 16th, 17th. It's really interesting. Moose are really concentrated on when they have calves. It's within about a 2 to 4 week period, 90% of your cows will have calves. So keep your eyes peeled and think positive. We can get to twins and go from there. So from that, I'll take questions and thank you for your time and for listening in.
Okay, thank you, Henry. That was great. It's kind of sad to see what has been happening to the population, but there's sounds like there's a lot of hope. So that's a good message. I do have one little brief question for you. In terms of the history, prior to, you know, the 1980s, in the graph that you showed earlier from where you started, what was going on with the moose population before that?
Yeah, so back to about 1900. In 1900, there were very few moose reported to be in New Hampshire. And that's because at that time, it was largely cleared and farmland. And so, you know, there was really not much habitat for moose, not much forage out there. Additionally, they'd been heavily hunted for food or heavily taken for food for subsistence by subsistence hunting. And so there were very few moose. Pre-colonization, how many moose were in New Hampshire? We don't, you know, there aren't good records of that. But you have to think back to what influences moose abundance. And that is also the abundance of young forest. And so that's patchy and temporal. So you probably had areas that had moderate to high moose abundance for a while. And once that forest regrew to 20 years old or older, then that would shift a little bit as well. So generally low to moderate with patchy distribution.
Okay, thank you. And with that, I think what we're gonna do is turn this over to Judy Tomosa, who's gonna be monitoring the questions in the Q&A box. Folks, if you have any questions, please post them there for Henry.
Yes, Henry, thank you for the wonderful presentation. And I can tell by some of the questions that we have a lot of folks that are concerned about the moose. If they haven't seen one, they hope they can always see one. If they haven't hunted for one, they hope they have that option as well. One of the questions concerns you showed the range of where the moose lives. And the viewer would like to know if other states and other provinces have as serious a winter tick issue as New Hampshire does. And if so, what is their management strategy? Is it the same as ours or are they doing anything differently?
Sure, yeah. Let's go back to a slide that will be helpful for us. So here is a map of the Northeast with our area of highest winter tick impact. And so, So Northeast Vermont, the Northeast Kingdom, they also see very high winter tick impact, as does Western Maine. just about above where that dashed line is, the Maine Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife is starting an adaptive management zone where they're going to try to manage for fewer moose but healthier moose by reducing moose abundance through hunting, and therefore hoping to see fewer winter ticks. Vermont is proceeding with a similar approach of managing for fewer but healthier moose in the Northeast Kingdom through hunting removals, but they are easing into that strategy.
And I assume that we all understand that wildlife and moose do not respect political boundaries. They'll go between towns, they'll go between counties, they'll go between states, although it's a little difficult to cross the Connecticut River between New Hampshire and Vermont. So are the other states, are you in a lot of constant touch with each other to sort of coordinate your management since the moose can move between different locations?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, no, it's all the same moose. You know, for a moose to move 10 to 20 miles, it's no big deal. And so not that that's what they commonly do, but for them to do that, it's yeah, not out of the question at all. And so, yes, we absolutely work collaboratively and on management as well as research. You know, a lot of the research started by Dr. Peter Pekins at the University of New Hampshire and my predecessor, Christine Rhines, the research initiated by them blossomed into a regional effort with study areas in Vermont and Maine and involvement by the University of Vermont as well. And so there is a lot of collaboration. It's a regional effort, and we learned a tremendous amount, over, I want to say, 800 radio marked moose between the three states. So, yep.
And another viewer wants to know, since we already know that the tick is the issue with the moose, why are we continuing to do research? Are we learning anything else or anything more from the continued research that you're all doing?
Great. Yeah, no. So the continued research is really letting us understand that winter tick life cycle, the impacts to moose. And what we don't know is, you know, this is a complex relationship that involves winter ticks, abundance, moose abundance, and climate. And that climate, that weather impact is always changing, and it changes by where you are. So this research really is helping us understand that. And we don't exactly know at what level of moose will result in healthier moose due to lower winter ticks. And so research is really looking to hone our monitoring ability to understand how do we improve moose health and take it one step further. So we're always learning more and getting a better handle on what's going on.
Somebody wants to know, and I always hear this question no matter where I am, even though I'm not a moose expert, is there any way to kill the ticks?
Yeah, so as far as management-wise, the only management recommendation we have right now is to manage for fewer moose. The other ways that are commonly suggested are to apply pesticides. And so that is currently not recommended for a number of reasons. There's information on the New Hampshire Fish and Game website for that that addresses that. But it's a number of reasons that result. One is there are cascading effects of applying pesticides to a landscape that are hard to estimate. Additionally, that a realistic way of doing that has not been perceived, or a chemical treatment that works. And so not that we're recommending that, but that's the information that's available. The third way that's commonly brought up would be burning, prescribed burns to kill ticks. Yes, that can be effective with a deep, slow burn. However, to be able to do that on a landscape level to influence winter tick abundance would be very challenging, probably unrealistic.
Another viewer would like to know, how does the calving period in the southern counties compare to the northern counties? Is it generally weeks ahead?
So it's a great question. We have not marked moose in the southern counties to know if it is different. However, what information comes from Massachusetts and the incidental reports of moose calves, it suggests it's the same. Like this morning, I got a report of a cow moose that unfortunately died while having a calf in Canaan. So information that we have suggests is similar. We don't have concrete data on that.
And I think you addressed this, but somebody would like to know, how do deer pick up brainworm?
Yep, deer also get brainworm through ingesting the larva, similar to moose. So they accidentally ingest snails and slugs while browsing and also get that worm in that way.
And I know you mentioned a couple of things about what we can do to help support or improve the moose population. Someone is asking, is there anything that local landowners can do? If we don't own a big tract of land, is there any type of management that someone can do on their property to benefit moose?
Sure, yeah. You know, so I would say, one, try to conserve your property. You know, if you can keep it in open space, great. Work with a licensed professional forester who's going to give you, you know, professional advice and try to understand the management of that property in the greater context of the landscape. And then I also wouldn't hesitate to reach out to your regional fish and game biologist. You know, if you're looking to manage your property for wildlife, moose will fit in with the general recommendations that are best for that property that would benefit a variety of species.
Okay, and Henry, is there any other question that you're typically asked that we haven't covered that you'd like to share that you think would be helpful to the audience today?
Yeah, I think one question that is typically asked is, what, you know, are moose the only species affected, and why are they affected more than others? And so, yeah, I guess on that front, that, you know, I would just like to mention moose are the species in New Hampshire that are affected the most. Elk and caribou can also be infected. But obviously we don't have those here. And so why aren't other species affected the way moose are? Infected and affected, I'm really getting tongue-tied here. So really it goes back to, you know, the evolutionary time frame that moose have spanned, occurring with winter ticks. So moose came to North America across the Bering Land Bridge. And I'll just move forward to a slide that briefly recommends this, or covers this. And so they came to North America across the Bering Land Bridge. And so they have a short evolutionary with winter ticks, which started in central North America and moved north. And so moose are poor groomers. They don't try to groom. They don't try to itch and get those ticks, or don't try to get those ticks off until it itches. White-tailed deer and many other species have spent quite a long time with winter ticks and other tick species, and they've moved north with winter ticks. White-tailed deer are stimulus groomers, so they are constantly grooming, constantly getting the ticks off, resulting in them not having high infestations. So that's the basic reason why moose are the most affected of our species in New Hampshire.
And we had a question about how many moose hunting permits are we allowing this year?
The New Hampshire Fish and Game is issuing 42 moose hunting permits in 2021.
Okay, Henry, that just about wraps up the questions on moose. Thank you very much. Unless you have any final comment, here's your chance.
I would just like to say thank you for tuning in. Thank you for your interest and enthusiasm for moose. And yeah, we're lucky to have moose, and I think we can do our best to conserve them here in the state.
Thank you very much, Henry. We did have a final question about beaver. I won't ask you to answer that. It says, I've heard that beaver can have a local mitigating effect on climate change because their activities result in greater CO2 captured by trees. Is there also an impact on beaver because of generally lower pond levels and occasional flooding? That's an excellent segue into our next webinar, which Laura will be talking about extreme storms and flooding. I will briefly say that extreme storms and flooding can have an impact on beavers because their dams can be flooded out just like anyone else's. If you'd like to know a little bit more about that, then I invite you to tune into our next webinar, which will be on June 17th. So we wanted to bring the beaver in, but thank you very much, Henry, about all your information on the moose. Thank you. And now I'll turn it back to Laura.
All right. Thank you, Judy. Henry, I'm going to try to share a slide. If you would unshare that. Okay. So basically what I wanted to cover here as we're sort of coming to the end. Again, any of these things can be found on our Fish and Game website. I know Nicole's been posting these all along, but the link is right up there at wildlife.nh.com/climate. And it also shows a lot of links to partners and organizations and with a lot more information on ways to get involved. One of those organizations is Taking Action for Wildlife. They have lots and lots of opportunities for you to get involved. And also in just as a comment in regards to someone else that asked about what can you do locally for, say, moose, you can check with your local conservation commission. Some of the planning organizations and committees in your town, those folks are using the Wildlife Action Plan often. And they are, moose are one of the animals or species that are in that plan. And so there may be things going on there that you could actually get involved with. So don't hesitate to reach out locally. I would also like to point out again, just as our next webinar is called Reconnecting the Watershed. It will be, as Judy said, June 16th, 2021 at the same time, 12 noon. You can go back to our website, to our climate change pages, and check for the links when they get posted. Our main presenter will be Diane Timmons, who is our Fisheries and Cold Water Project leader. And also she'll be joined a little bit by John McGee, who is our Fisheries Habitat Research and Management Programs Coordinator. So a lot of experience and information there to share. So again, all of these will be posted on our website and our YouTube channel. So please share and come back and see them. And before you sign off, also, we're going to be sending you a survey when you do sign off. We'd appreciate it if you'd fill that back in and return it or submit it so that we can continue to improve on these webinars. So until the next webinar, thank you for joining us today. We hope to see you then. And get outside and enjoy New Hampshire's wildlife. Thank you.